Welcome everyone on this webinar that we have for strategies to make it big in short-term trading. So this webinar will be covering some of the key topics, that is introduction to trading is one, then what exactly is short-term trading or swing trading, and then the next I'll be talking about how to select a short-term trade. And then I would be talking about how to set stops, that is stop losses. And last, I'd be talking about the odds against you. What are the odds against you when you are in the market? So these are the areas that I'll be covering in this webinar. So on the introduction to trading, what you need to realize is that trading is something wherein you can be free. You can live and work anywhere in the world. You can be independent from routine and not answer to anyone. This is the life of a successful trader. So a successful trader, he can be independent and he can just today with technology being available, he can trade from anywhere. But at the same time, what you need to understand is that you can succeed in trading only if you handle it as a serious intellectual pursuit. Emotional trading can be lethal. Generally, what we see is that people get wrapped in their emotions while trading. And then they basically exit from the market, taking a loss. So to help ensure success, practice defensive money management. So I'll be talking about that as well. Apart from that, what a good trader does is that a good trader watches his capital as carefully as a professional scuba diver watches his air supply. So this is a very important, I would say, analogy. That a professional scuba diver who dives under the water, when he's inside the water, he is having his oxygen cylinder. So he has his eyes on his air supply. So similarly, a good trader needs to watch out for his capital. That is the amount that he's bringing as margin in his account. So that's very important. And the trader has to study trends and reversals in the market the way a sailor studies the ocean. When a sailor is in the ocean, he has his compass, he understands the weather, how the wind is blowing, and then he decides to sail. So similarly, a trader has to study trends and reversals in the market. The trader must trade on a small scale while learning to handle his account. So if you are new to trading, you should trade small. You should not take a huge risk that one trade going against you and your capital gets wiped out, or you lose a significant percent of your capital. So you should start small and then increase your position as you gain experience and as you gain knowledge. So you need to understand that you can never control the market, but you can learn to control yourself. This is something which is very important and very crucial, because the market plays out our emotions and we have to control our emotions when we are in the market. So if you look at a professional trader, so a professional trader uses his head and stays calm, whereas amateurs become excited or depressed. So if amateurs means those who are not professional traders or those who are not seriously trading, when they make profits, they become very happy. When they make losses, they become sad, they become emotional, they become depressed. But you need to remember that these emotions are your enemies. These emotions are the roadblocks to your becoming a successful trader. So emotional trading is a luxury that nobody can afford. And the only reason there is money in the markets is that other traders put it there. And the money you want to make belongs to other people who have no intention of giving it to you. So the point here is that you need to understand that the market, you've got all market participants, various types of market participants who are present in the market, and they have money in the sense that they are buying stocks, selling stocks, they are buying futures or options and selling and building positions. So it is their money and they have no intention of giving that money to you. So those who are knowledgeable, those who have the experience, those who manage their emotions well, they are the ones who are the ones who become successful in the markets. So generally what happens is that your human nature leads you to give up your independence under stress. when we are under stress, we generally look for advice and views from other people. So when you put on a trait, you feel the desire to imitate others, overlooking objective signals. This is why you need to write down and follow your trading system or strategy and money management rules. They represent your rational individual decisions made before you enter a trade. So the point you need to remember is that before entering a trade, you have to be very clear as to why you are entering the trade. One, secondly, what is the risk that you are taking? And thirdly, when you will get out if you are in profit. So these are the few things that you really need to remember. Apart from that, you have to observe yourself and notice changes in your mental state as you trade. As I said earlier, that if you are in profit, you become happy. If you are in loss, you become sad or depressed or angry. But then you need to remember that these are the very emotions which are impacting your mental state negatively. And you have to observe yourself. Because if you observe yourself, then you will realize your emotional state which you are in. So you should write down your reasons for entering a trade and rules for getting out of it, including money management rules. And you may not change your plan while you have an open position. So if you have an open position, you should not change your plan midway. You should have an exit strategy before placing a trade. So successful trading stands on three pillars. First is you need to analyze the balance of power between the bulls and bears. If the bulls are stronger, you should be with the bulls. If the bears are stronger, you should be with the bears. So for that, you need to analyze the balance of power. Who's stronger? Markets are a two-party system, bulls and bears. So you should identify, and I will tell you how you can do that going forward. And so that's one. Second is you need to practice good money management, because money management is more or less how you manage your risk, how you manage your capital. And the third is you need personal discipline to follow your trading plan and avoid getting high or depressed in the markets. So personal discipline is very important. That's your mind. Then your money management is required and your methods. So how do you analyze the markets? So I'll be talking about all of that. So you need to look at this, that a trader who counts his profits in an open trade is like a lawyer who in the middle of a trial starts dreaming of what he'll buy with his fees. So the example here is that if there is a very good lawyer and he's arguing in court, and in the middle of a trial he starts thinking, okay, this much money I will make from this trial, and this I will buy, or this I'll do, this I'll do that. So do you think he'll be able to argue well in the court? No, because now his mind gets diverted. So as a trader also, you need to not focus on the profits during the trade, because that's something which will make you very emotional, or the loss. You need to plan it out before entering the trade. And this is what professional traders do. Professional traders don't count money in open trades, what is called paper profits. So you're not counting your paper profits, because that's basically you are playing into your emotions. The professional traders do it at the end of the accounting period, which would be a month. So now we come to what exactly is short-term trading. It's also called swing trading. Basically, there are three forms of trading. One is the long-term trading, which you can call investing. The second is short-term trading, or it's also called swing trading. And third is day trading. So in this webinar, I'll be talking about short-term trading. So short-term, and as I said, it's also called swing trading. So swing trading teaches you faster than long-term investing, where lessons take years to complete. So swing trading is a faster teacher. So you learn fast when you are into swing trading. Swing trading gives you time to think, unlike day trading, which demands instant reactions. If you're trading intraday, then your reaction has to be very fast, very quick, because there is one particular news and the market goes for a toss, or there is one positive news and you see a rapid movement up in the market, or it could be a particular stock. So the reaction time is the lowest in day trading. It is higher in swing trading and the highest in long-term investing. So swing trading, so short-term swings can be substantial enough to generate meaningful profits. Also, swing trades don't require watching the screen all the day. So swing trading does not require watching the screen all the day. Swing trading generally refers to a holding period from a few days or two, or it could be 2 or 3 weeks. So swing trading generally refers to a holding period from a few days or 2 or 3 weeks. So that's the holding period that you have for swing trading. Now we look at how to select a short-term trade. Whatever approach you take, the key advantage of any system is that you design it when markets are closed and you feel calm. So a system basically becomes your anchor of rational behavior amidst turbulence of the market. So generally what happens is that a short-term, when you are into short-term trading or swing trading, you see the prices moving and you see volatility in the markets. So if you have a system or or a strategy which you have defined or developed before the market before the market trades or when the markets are closed, then all you have to do is to follow the rules. That lets you have a rational behavior amidst this all this volatility in the markets. So generally there are three key demands for every trade. One, you have a trade setup. So here you write down the three key numbers for every trade. First of all, your entry, where you want to enter, at what point you want to enter. Second is, what is the target? And third, what is the stop? That is the stop loss. So your entry, your target point, and your stop loss, they need to be clearly defined before you enter a particular trade. So before entering the market, you need to decide how much you'll pay, how much you'll risk, and how much you expect to gain. And also you need to understand is that the trade, just we have taken a trade, does not mean that the trade is going to be profitable. It could be profitable, it could be a loss as well. So you have to be prepared for both. The next is risk management. Here you need to decide in advance how many rupees you are prepared to risk on this particular trade. And you divide that amount by your risk per share. So which is the distance from your entry to your stop. So I'll just explain with an example. Say for example, you're buying a particular stock, which is trading at 200 rupees. And you feel that the stop loss ideally should be 194. So the risk that you are taking per share is rupees 6. Now, if you want to buy 1,000 shares of that particular company, so effectively you are risking 1,000 into 6, that is 6,000 rupees is a risk that you are taking. Now you should always look at it also from the total capital that you have. Say for example, the margin that is there in your account. So if you have a margin of say 50,000 rupees, or just to make it simple, if you have a margin of say 60,000 rupees, so you are risking 6,000 on a particular trade. So effectively you are taking a 10% risk on your margin, which is a very high risk. So ideally you should, I'll be talking about that as well later, but here I would just like to elaborate is that you should not risk more than 2% of your total capital on a particular trade. So what it effectively means is that if you have 1 lakh, so 2,000 is the risk. So if 6 rupees is a stop loss, so ideally you can buy 300 shares of that particular company. There also you need to understand that if you're buying 300 shares and if the share price is 200, so effectively 60,000, your total capital is being blocked in that particular stock. So you have to look at it from two perspectives. One is the total margin money that you want to deploy in a particular stock, and secondly the risk that you want to take. So this will really help you protect yourself in markets in times which are extremely volatile, and it would also significantly reduce your chance of a major loss. So this will give you the number of shares you may trade. Last but not the least, every single trade must be based on some, you should have some strategy or some system in place. Then we look at the ways how to select a short-term trade. Here we have a different way of looking at markets. Markets, you can look at it in a single time frame, you can look at it at from multiple time frames. So in this we have the first screen, which is called we are talking about swing trading. So here we'll be looking at weekly charts, we'll be looking at daily charts, and we'll be looking at hourly charts. So we'll be talking about that. If you are a long-term trader, long-term investor, then you can look at monthly charts, weekly charts, and daily charts. If you're a day trader, then ideally you can look at daily charts, hourly charts, and a 15-minute chart. So here we'll be more concentrated on a swing trading. So it will be on hourly charts. Your entry and exits would be based on hourly charts, because the position that you'll be holding is from a couple of days to a couple of weeks. So because that's short-term trading. So here in the first first screen that you look at is a weekly chart. So you have to look at a weekly chart, and you analyze the long-term chart here. In that case, you first look at the weekly chart, how the weekly chart is there. And when you analyze weekly charts, your perspective will be 5 times greater than that of competitors, because generally people look at the daily charts and everyone is looking at just the daily charts. But here what you do is you start looking at first the weekly charts, and here you can use the slope of the exponential moving average 10 period, or you can use an MACD histogram with 12, 26, 9, the default parameters for your study. And you can see that the MACD histogram, when it is positive, when it is, and when the bars are growing taller, every bar is taller, that means the trend strength is there. So that means you should be on the long side of the market. So any opportunity should be used as a buying opportunity. So that's the first screen. That's the weekly, and that's the market tide, you can call it. That's a weekly chart. Then we come to the next screen, wherein what you do is you look at the daily chart. So what you started with is first you've understood the trend of the market. So you're looking at the weekly chart, and with the slope of the exponential moving average and with the MACD histogram, you see that the stock is moving up. So any dip should be used as a buying opportunity. So when the weekly trend is up, daily declines points to buying opportunities. And when the weekly trend is down, daily rallies points to shorting opportunities. And here you can apply oscillators such as stochastics, RSI. They give trading signals when they enter buy or sell zone. So you have your overbought zone, oversold zone. So you can look at that. So for example, when the weekly MACD histogram rises, but the daily stochastics falls below 30, it identifies an oversold territory. Likewise, when weekly MACD histogram declines, but daily stochastics rises above 70, it identifies an overbought area, so a shorting opportunity. So in this screen, what you see is this is the market wave. So the first screen is a weekly chart, when you are seeing the trend of the week. And in the second screen, there is a daily chart, you are identifying overbought or oversold zone. So if the trend is up, so you are identifying on daily charts oversold zones. And if the trend on weekly is down, then you are identifying overbought zones on in daily chart. So in this example, if you look that here the weekly trend is positive, that is the screen one is positive, and the market tide, if you see, is positive. So in the second screen, the daily screen, you can see in particular, if you look at this particular zone here, which is in oversold territory. So what it effectively means is that this can be a somewhat buying opportunity for you, because the trend is up, and here on the daily charts there is a correction. So this can be used as a buying opportunity. So you have seen now a weekly chart, you've seen a daily chart. Now you are looking at an hourly chart. So because you can enter even on daily charts. So what you can do here is that once it comes in the oversold territory, you can, once the previous high is breached, you can enter a trade with a stop loss below the recent bottom. So your stop loss can be below this red line. So it's somewhere around 1260. So you can trade that way also. Apart from that, if you want further, if you are looking at the charts on a real time basis, then you can enter even on hourly charts. So here this clearly defines the entry point. So the third screen is your entry point using an hourly chart. Here we are using Bollinger Bands. You have the default parameters, which are there, 22. So 20 is the average and 2 is the standard deviation. So in this case, entry is initiated when prices close above the lower band after closing below. So what you see is that, and this is happening around the same time when you are having a on the daily chart. So you are seeing that the market closes below the band, and then you have this green candle which closes above the band. So once it closes above the band, you can buy with a stop loss, recent lowest stop loss, and then you can hold your position. So this is something which you can definitely, all of you, you can definitely try this out, work this out. And if you have any queries, you can write to us at webinars@angelbroking.com. I will address your queries. And what you need to understand here is that the Bollinger Bands create entry points. So your stop loss can be below the recent low, and the target could be either touching the higher of the bands. Your target could be somewhere around here. It touches the higher band, or it could be twice the risk. That means if you're risking 50 rupees, their target ideally should be 100 rupees. Or otherwise, you can also trail with the help of a parabolic SAR. So that's something which you can use. So there are other many indicators which you can use, but these are the most popular ones which you can use for your exits. Now we'll talk about how to set stops. So because what you see is, and there's one more thing I would like to add here, is that just I've shown you how you can enter on the buy side. The opposite can be done on the sell side. So what I would want all of you to do is that you should also look for opportunities on the sell side with exactly the same strategy. And if you have any queries, you can write to us at webinars@angelbooking.com. We'll address your queries. So how to set stops? Now we'll talk about how to set stops, because it's very very much important that if you are building a position, if you're taking a position, then ideally you should have a stop loss, because if you don't have a stop loss and the market goes against you, you could end up with a significant loss which could wipe out your entire capital also. So having a stop is more or less it's like a protective gear for you. So the ways you can put a stop is, first is below the recent low. So as I showed in this, this is the recent low. So if you're buying here, your stop loss ideally should be below this recent low. It should not be exactly the low, it should be slightly below the low. So if the low was 1250, so you could have 1247 as a stop loss. So that's one way you can have a stop. The second is below pivot support, or support one, support two. What happens is that there is a pivot calculation which basically looks at the open high low values and plots the support and resistance level. So you can use, if you want to keep a large stop loss, then support two, ideally your stop loss should be below support two. And if you want to have a tight stop loss, then you can use support one. Likewise, if you're on the sell side, then you can use resistance one or resistance two. The third is you can use a parabolic SAR. That's an indicator, very good indicator. But generally, there is, all indicators, they work, they don't work all the time, but they work in different scenarios. So parabolic SAR works very well in trending markets, but in trendless markets, you can get whipsawed. So if the market is moving has moved fast in your favor, then a parabolic SAR can be a very good tool to actually trail your profits. Apart from that, you can use some candlestick patterns, such as if you're on the buy side, say there's a major candle bullish candlestick formation, such as a hammer or a bullish engulfing pattern for a buy. So that can be, you can have a stop loss below that. Or if there is a major bearish candlestick pattern, say for example a hanging man or shooting star or a bearish engulfing pattern, so you can have your sell stop above the high of that pattern. Apart from that, support and resistance levels, key support and resistance levels can also be used. So if there is a key support level, you can have a buy trade and the stop loss below that support level. Or a key resistance level is there, so if you want to sell, the stop loss should be above that key resistance level. And as I had mentioned earlier also, that don't risk more than 2% of your capital on any particular trade. Some people go as high as 5%, but that's... So what it effectively means is that if you're risking 2% of your capital on a particular trade, so if 50 trades go wrong, then your entire capital gets wiped out. Now if you're having 5% taking 5% risk on a particular trade, what it effectively means is that if 20 trades go wrong, you are out of the market. But many of the people, they risk 10%, 20% and 30% on a particular trade. So if you are risking 30% of your capital on a particular trade, three trades go wrong and you are out of the market. So you can't blame the market for your losing such a significant amount of money. So two things that you need to remember is that you should have some decent capital to start with, and secondly, don't risk more than 2%. It would go max to 3%, but not more than that. And as I said, that all these examples that I've explained, they are more on the buy side. So you can likewise use the strategy on the sell side. So the strategy becomes exactly the opposite in case of sell trades. So here I would like to talk something about that the odds basically are against you. So the mental baggage from childhood can prevent you from succeeding in the markets. So what you need to understand is that you have a very good strategy, but your inner weakness, that is your emotional quotient and your way of thinking, your mental aptitude, your moods, they have a significant impact on your succeeding or failing in the markets. So you need to understand and realize and identify what your weaknesses are, and you need to work to change them. So because we all are emotional beings, but there's no place for emotions in the markets, and the emotions that come to play in the markets are primarily your fear, greed and hope. And fear is the most overpowering. That's why you see when the market corrects, everyone is trying to exit the trade, everyone is trying to book the loss, and that's when magic happens at the market, basically bounces back from there. So you need to some way, and everyone has to deal it separately. So you'll have to identify what your weaknesses are and work to change upon them, improve upon them, because till the time you really don't change your psychology towards trading, you might have the best system, but still you'll not be able to make money because you are still trading on your emotions. So that's something which you need to do. Secondly, you need to keep a trading diary. That is, you should have at least a fair reason as to why you're entering a trade or exiting a trade, and you should look for repetitive patterns of success and failure. Because if you have a system, if you have some strategy, the strategy could work, it could not work, but then you could always keep on trying and finding out better ways. But the strategies which I mentioned here, you could definitely try them out. They'll be good for you. And so finally, to be a successful trader, you need to choose a small number of markets. See, if you're day trading, then ideally you should not look at more than three to four stocks or indices. So if you're a day trader, then ideally Nifty, Bank Nifty, they are the best to trade, most liquid, best to trade. If you're a short-term trader or a swing trader, then you can have a couple of dozen stocks which you can look at, because you're looking at it from a end-of-day perspective. And then if you are trading from a real-time perspective, then you can look at some more. Then you need to select a few tools and learn to use them well, because there are hundreds and hundreds of indicators. So when there are hundreds of indicators, but the parameters they use are primarily price and volume and open interest. So it wouldn't make a very great difference if you're using 15 indicators or 20 indicators. Ideally 3 to 4 indicators, or maximum 5 is fine. You shouldn't be using more than that. Use at least 2 time frames, but not more than 3 time frames. As I showed you, you look at the weekly charts, you look at the daily charts, and if you want, you can look at the hourly charts. If you don't have time, even the daily charts should suffice and should be helpful to you. Because if you're using more than 3 time frames, that adds more clutter, that adds more to the cluttering of the decision making. So your decision making gets cluttered because you have too much of noise, which is there, and the signal is more now. is more mixed in the noise, so you would not be able to take the right decision. As it is wisely said that too much analysis leads to paralysis. And more so if you're trading from a short-term perspective, if you're trading from a day trading, then you don't have any time to analyze much. You have to take the decision then and there. Whereas in swing trading, as I mentioned, or in short-term trading, you still have some window of opportunity or the time. Time is there for you to analyze to a certain extent, because your position generally is held for a couple of days to a couple of weeks. And the most important is trading is a journey of self-discovery. You might have the best rifle, but you might not be the best shooter because you have not trained yourself. So if you don't train yourself, and also if you don't understand what your weaknesses are, what your strengths are, then trading is difficult. But if you the moment you understand and also you realize that there is no place for ego in the markets, and ultimately the markets are what they are, and you have to accept the markets as they are, then you are on the path of successful trading. That's why trading is a journey of self-discovery. Apart from that, I would like to talk about angel product. So because I was explaining to you on the charting side, so now the question is, where do you get to see that? We currently have this facility in our Speed Pro. So if you are interested in having access to this, you can write to ebroking@angelbroking.com and you can mention your client code and request for activation of this angel advanced chart. But this is more for those on the real time trading basis. If you're not trading on a real time basis but still want to go in for short term trading or swing trading, you can look at the charts which are available and you can use them. So that would really help. This is a very good charting application. Angel, we don't charge anything for it, but we have a price that you pay for it. It is very popular. It has all the indicators, and also you can have your different screens put together. So my advice to everyone on the call is that you should definitely look at it, provided you have the time. If you don't have the time, then you can do end of day studies, EOD studies as well. You can look at charts which are available on many popular websites, and you can use some of the indicators which I mentioned, and you can start looking at the markets. Because if you look at the markets technically, because generally what happens is that if you are investing or if you're trading from a long-term perspective, then it's majorly the fundamentals that are impacting the markets. But from a short-term or intraday perspective, it's more of the market sentiments, and technical analysis tries to capture those sentiments very well through charts. So that advantage you have. Also, if you spend some time learning Japanese candlesticks, that also will be a very positive for you. So with this, I conclude this webinar. If you have any questions, we can take your questions. Thank you.